Hi, this is MC Jetty for a new episode of my modding tutorials. This is episode 11. In the previous episode we saw how you could make sure that when you break the furnace it will keep its contents. In this episode we are first going to add a config file, but also we're going to do some cleanup of the code, fix some dangling things, in general make sure that the code base is okay. And that's something, I think it's important to do that from time to time. Just don't stop adding new features, but make sure that what's there is okay and that the code is in a good shape. So first though, I want to upgrade this. Someone mentioned to me that these mappings are actually pretty old. What do these mappings do? They are responsible for translating the obfuscated internal names from the decompiled Minecraft code to more readable, human-readable names. So we're going to upgrade them and to see which are stable. For your version of Minecraft, you can go to this site, this here, and you can see here daily snapshots. Those are for 1.13, but this is the one that we want to use, stable 39, stable underscore 39. So let's try it out, and normally should be able to just run this again. Yeah, it's okay, that's good. Is it done already? Seems like it's... Oh, it was just starting. Okay, build successful. Now, I'm not sure if it's needed, but I'm going to refresh the Gradle as well. Seems okay. And let's compile everything to see that things still work. Yeah, so I wasn't using any names that have been changed. I don't know if there were any changes, but it's okay. So, the first thing that I want to do is add the configuration file. And this time I'm going to learn together with you, because I'm going to use a way to make configs that I haven't done myself. I usually, because my mods are, most of them are a bit older, I use the original API for the config system. But recently, Forge added, I don't know if it's recently, but Forge added an annotation system for configuration some time ago, and it starts with this. Yeah, like that. Okay. By the way, let's... where I find this information is a good Forge documentation. This is a very good site for Forge documentation in general, and there are various concepts that are explained here in depth. It's a really good resource. Config annotations. Let's make this bigger. So here you can see some information on how to use this, but I will explain it to you now as I started using it myself. Yeah, that's okay. So basically what this says is all public fields in this class will be marked as configuration. So for example, It's configurable, I mean. Let's remove these four and let's it's these four that I have to remove. So max power is in these. I want to move to general config like that. Now they are here, and now this should actually be sufficient, so let's see if it works. This is the first time I'm doing it myself, so learning with you. Oh. Yeah, I'm doing the setup again because this was in my run environment. Hold on. Okay, so apparently there are some names that have changed. IntelliJ just did catch it. So set unlocalized name has changed. And it has changed to set, where is it again? Set translation key. And there is also another change here. Get front. Which is actually completely removed, apparently. Hold on, let me look up how that should work. Okay, so apparently it's by index this time. Okay, so that fixes this. Alright, so essentially nothing has changed here. There are still the same methods that we're calling as before, but because the mappings have been updated and I was using pretty old mappings, you have to use other names, and sometimes it's a bit hard to find out which it is, but it's okay now. So let's now test if it works. You don't actually need to fire up to load the world to test this. It should have made it a configuration file, and here you see it actually did. So very easy, just this, and you have a configuration file. That's all there is to it. And I think, let me check something. If you go here, yeah, these values are also in the game, like this. Now there are some extra things that you can do. So let's delete this so it is regenerated again next time. You can, and it's recommended to do that, comment. Oh, number of ticks for one smelting operation. Maximum amount of power for the fast furnace. Also, we probably want to put this in a section. Let me check. Is there something like sections? This is also something I wonder what the default is actually. I think probably that the default is that it's not needed. But let's do it a bit different here. fast furnace, and let's call this fast furnace config instead, because if we have other machines we will need sieve and use while smelting. Okay, so that's this part, and I think you can also make other sections easily. By the way, you can also set range int and min is 1, max, we leave max alone, that's okay. Yeah, the rest is okay, just to try things. Let's see what happens now. Oh, it's now probably called, by the way, you can find this config, fastfurnace.config. Yeah, it says it had some comments. Yeah, okay. But I was actually hoping to have this in my mod.config, but we have a section. Have to check. Ah, category. Yeah, name is just for the config file. Okay, so that's what I should do. So let's try it again. Let's remove these two. And let's do it like this. So it's after all a pretty easy system to use. Yeah, that's better. Now you get the category, and if you make multiple of these for different machines, you can get multiple sections in your config file. Okay, so that concludes the first part of this tutorial. Let's update things to stable and also implement a config file. Then there are some other things I want to do. First, remember that we had that problem with the state of the furnace going off and then next tick going to working again. So there's every time it starts a new smelting operation, there is a slight, you can see it because it goes off and to working immediately. I want to avoid that. So to do that, I'm going to remove this. And check how we will use this. So let's set this to off here. And in this case we shouldn't do this. Let's just return here. And actually this is another bug fix. Let's remove this one. So what happens now? With this line here, like it was before, it will go over all input slots. It will check what the result is of smelting that, and it will see if it has room to insert that. And problem was this break. I just noticed this bug. If there is no room to smelt this item, it will stop processing immediately and not check the other input slots, because maybe there is something there that can be smelted that has where there is room for in the output, because there may be a partial stack there. So this is actually wrong, but we should put a return here. And set furnace to working. If it's already at working, nothing will happen because of set state function does this compare. So this so we found the bug, I fixed it. So that's another good reason why you should look over your code. But let's try it out. Okay, so let's see. Yeah, this one has no power. So actually, oh, let's see what happens when it goes out of power. Yeah, okay, so that appears to be working. Okay, another thing that is a bit of a problem. You see the particles when the block is broken? Let's show it again. Those are the missing texture particles. I want to fix that too. And that should be a matter of doing this. You can use any texture, but it's usually best to just use the texture of the block itself. So again, let's try it out. See? Much better. Yeah. Also, I did notice something else. The front panel doesn't appear to be working the first time you load the world. Yeah, indeed. It needs... Not sure what triggers it. But if you break it and put it back, it's actually okay. So that's something we have to fix as well. Let's find out what's wrong. So I found out what's wrong. It's another bug. Not a dramatic one, but still a bug. Problem is that when this update is called, and so after the world is loaded, the tile entity will tick once. It will call set state, no power, and the default state is off. So that means that this will actually trigger. But the problem is, apparently, and I didn't know that myself, this does not work yet. This packet is never fired, so you're probably too early in the startup process for this to be set up. But it's easy to fix. I just have to add the state to the NPT of the tile entity, and same here. Not in the restorable, that's not something we want to restore, but it will be restored by the update function. But we do it in write to NBT, read from NBT, because that means that after the block is loaded, after the world is loaded, the state will already be to reset to the state of the server. So that works much better. So that's another fix that we have to do. And the final thing for this tutorial, so let's commit these. Fix problem with smelting, fix problem with initial front panel state, fix baking particle. Like this. Another, the final thing that I want to do for this tutorial is make something more efficient, and that's in our container. I mentioned that last time. So we have actually, if progress changes and energy changes, we fire two things, and that's not very efficient. You want to reduce communication over the network as much as possible. So I want to combine the progress and the power in one package so that it's synced at the same time. So first we're going to rename this packet sync machine state, because it's not only about power now. So we rename this private int progress. Progress is buf.read byte, because we're going to store from 0 to 100. It's a percentage that we want to store. And like this. Always make sure that these two are symmetrical, otherwise you get big problems. Okay, and this we also rename e machine state container, and we call this just sync int progress, like that, and we need to fix our container. Set client progress like that. So here we have to also get our progress, so, and we have to test this. So if this is different or the energy is different, so we have to send the package if either one of those is different, and then we send this information. And then this can go away, and this can go away, like that. Actually, we don't want to send it's here. So the progress is actually numbered between 0 and 40. So we need to convert that to a percentage here. Replace this current. First furnace config.max progress. So that actually means that what we sent over is a percentage. So on the client side, our progress will be a percentage. So keep that in mind. The client progress on the server is different from the client progress on the client. Might be a bit confusing, but there are other ways to do this as well. But I think that's okay. So in our user interface, we actually only have to do this now. Oh yeah, I see. We actually have to do, let's go back, 100 minus. Let's try it out. Actually, we forgot something. We have to do this as well. Let's make it a bit. Okay, Okay, so it still works. It's sending energy and progress at the same time. So, and this should be more optimal. It will send a single package, and when both change at the same time, in the past it would send two packets, and now it's only one. So, we did some cleanups. So we generally made the mod a bit better. Okay, this concludes this tutorial. See you next time. Bye bye.